Buenos días y bienvenidos. Bienvenidos todos a la undécima edición de Energy Prospectives, que como sabrán todos ustedes es una iniciativa conjunta de la Fundación Naturgy y del IESE, que fomenta el punto de encuentro y debate entre expertos del sector energético con el fin de reflexionar sobre los grandes retos de la transformación del sistema energético global. En este saludo inicial incluyo también a las 600 personas registradas online. Es una gran satisfacción constatar el éxito de estas jornadas que tienen ya una marca propia. Y lo es también porque son el tipo de debate que nos gusta tener en el IESE por su enfoque estratégico de largo plazo, por la dimensión global de las reflexiones y por la trascendencia de las decisiones que reguladores y empresas están tomando, con un impacto significativo en la vida de las personas, a las que siempre situamos en el centro de la actividad de las organizaciones. Vemos cómo la transición energética constituye el fenómeno más transversal de la economía, con implicaciones en todos los sectores de la sociedad. Sin embargo, muchas veces esas implicaciones no son suficientemente explicadas y en ocasiones hasta los propios operadores y profesionales cercanos a la energía tienen difícil su conocimiento y cuantificación. De ahí el interés de esta nueva edición de Energy Prospectives, en la que se abordará el impacto que tiene la transición energética en el mercado laboral y en la economía. El profesor Christopher Pissarides abordará los efectos de la transición energética en el mercado laboral y el vicepresidente del Banco Central Europeo, Luis de Guindos, compartirá con nosotros su visión de la influencia que ejerce la transición energética sobre la economía. Son cuestiones de mucho calado que requieren un debate riguroso y bien fundamentado como el que hoy os proponemos. Expresar finalmente nuestro agradecimiento a Rafael Villaseca, presidente de la Fundación Naturgy, por impulsar y alentar estas jornadas al más alto nivel. A quien cedo la palabra con mucho gusto.
Muchas gracias, José Luis. Muy buenos días y bienvenidos a la edición número 11 de Energy Prospectives. Como ya se ha comentado, Energy Prospectives es una iniciativa conjunta del IESE y de la Fundación Naturgy que pretende promover un espacio de análisis y reflexión sobre el sector energético mediante jornadas como esta de hoy, en la que muy destacados ponentes abordan al más alto nivel temas importantes del sector de la energía. La Fundación Naturgy, que está cumpliendo 30 años de vida, dedica su esfuerzo y su presupuesto prácticamente por mitades a dos cuestiones que entendemos fundamentales. La primera es actividades sociales, donde dedicamos casi el 60% de nuestro esfuerzo y presupuesto, y la otra casi mitad a actividades de divulgación de datos, análisis, estudios, opiniones relevantes para el mundo de la energía. Y eso lo hacemos mediante publicaciones, notas, seminarios y jornadas. Eso es así porque creemos que disponer de datos e información adecuados es la base fundamental sobre la que se deben tomar buenas decisiones. Y sobre todo, y de manera muy especial, en el mundo de la energía. El mundo de la energía, actualmente, sin duda alguna, en boga y en la punta de lanza de muchas cuestiones, es un mundo muy complejo. Siempre lo ha sido, probablemente ahora más que en otros momentos. Es trascendente, desborda el sector por muchos lugares. Es un sector que cumplir sus tres objetivos, lo conocen, sostenibilidad económica, sostenibilidad ambiental y seguridad de suministro, se está convirtiendo en una de las claves del desarrollo de todos los países del mundo. Y porque además tiene un impacto sobre la economía general que en esos momentos se está ya viendo como absolutamente relevante para todo el mundo, especialmente el mundo occidental. Creemos, insisto, que el disponer de buena información debe ser algo fundamental. El no hacerlo o el tomar decisiones en todos los ámbitos públicos y privados sin tener bien presente las bases sobre las que se sustenta la real situación que vivimos o padecemos puede ser fuente después de errores, equivocaciones, retrasos y problemáticas derivadas, inconvenientes que dificulten la resolución de la presente crisis que estamos padeciendo. Y esta jornada está plenamente dedicada a todo ello, mediante dos temas importantes y conectados: la economía y el empleo y el efecto que tienen el mundo de la energía sobre ellos. Para enfocar esta cuestión, contamos hoy con dos ponentes y un moderador de excepción, que los conocen ustedes y que no voy a repetir sus amplios y dilatados currículums. Seguro que la presentación que hará de ellos el moderador será mucho más extensa, pero permítanme que les recuerde, en primer lugar, nuestro primer ponente de hoy, Luis de Guindos, ha sido, lo sabemos todos, ministro de Economía y ahora, en estos momentos, vicepresidente del Banco Central Europeo. Personalidad que, como la segunda que les comentaré, no necesita más presentación, pero que sin duda nos podrá ilustrar sobre esta cuestión tan relevante, la situación económica y su relación con el mundo de la economía. El segundo conferenciante de hoy, Christopher Pissarides, también es muy conocido, es actualmente profesor de la London School of Economics y fue galardonado el año 2010 con el Premio Nobel por sus trabajos relativos a la macroeconomía y el empleo. Cuestión también de enorme trascendencia y relevancia en los momentos que vivimos. Y van a estar moderados con el profesor Jordi Canals, también muy conocido por todos nosotros, que además de haber sido decano del Instituto de Estudios Superiores de la Empresa, en esos momentos es el titular de la Cátedra de Gobierno Corporativo del IESE. Creo que estamos seguros de contar con una jornada de excepción. I would like to finish this brief opening statement by thanking our speakers and the moderator for joining us today, and we look forward to their excellent contributions. Energy is already a key topic in the areas of business, technology, science, economic, society and politics. The current crisis serves to dramatically highlight this fact. The Naturgy Foundation, true to its goal, is dedicated to organizing events that throw light on important aspects related to the energy sector. In this light, we bring you today event with the invaluable collaboration of the IESE as part of the overall framework, a framework that gives us the opportunity to listen to the view of such important figures as Luis de Guindos and Christopher Pissarides, covering two of the defining questions of our day: the impact of the energy transition on the economy and the impact on employment. To adequately address these questions will require enormous expertise and precision, as the current problems are serious, and the possible alternatives both complex and difficult. For that reason, it makes sense to seek considered opinions from those who are in the best position to provide solutions and alternatives. In this sector and at this time, these are essential. Our foundation would humbly like to work to advance the understanding of the current energy crisis that we are suffering by making available the most accurate possible data and analysis. I believe today we are going to achieve that goal. Once again, I'd like to thank our speakers and moderators for their interest and kindness in agreeing to join us today and sharing their knowledge. Also, to the Naturgy Group, for the invaluable and consistent support they provide us, and to all of you for your interest and presence with us today. Many thanks, and gentlemen, the floor is yours.
Buenos días. Good morning. It is a tremendous pleasure and privilege to be able to be here with you, and especially to be in the company of two outstanding speakers, Professor Christopher Pissarides and Mr. Luis de Guindos. I think the theme of this session today, in the context of this Energy Prospectives series organized by Naturgy Foundation and IESE Business School, is to think deep about the process of energy transition, and in particular, the focus on the impact of this energy transition on the one hand on jobs, job creation, job destruction, and what's going to happen with jobs in declining sectors within the energy industry, and the emerging sectors that we see, but in many cases are not yet there. So this is a very important theme, and also the connections between energy transition and financial policy. And we have here, as you have already seen, we have here Professor Pissarides and Mr. Luis de Guindos. Let me just very briefly introduce both of them, We'll have for each one of them about a 30-minute presentation. And afterwards, we'll have a dialogue between Christopher Pissarides and Luis de Guindos, and then we'll open up the discussion, okay, with the questions coming from you, also questions coming from those of you attending this event online. So feel free to start thinking about questions, and some people will pick them up. Those of you online can write the questions, and I'll get the questions in my iPad. So this is going to be, I think, a very interactive session. Let me first introduce briefly both speakers. First, Professor Christopher Pissarides. Professor Pissarides is the Regius Professor of Economics at the London School of Economics. He was awarded the Nobel Prize in Economics back in 2010 for a very important contribution that he had developed himself, but also in cooperation with other authors on a better understanding of job markets. Job markets, very briefly, back in the 1980s and early 1990s, were understood essentially in terms of supply and demand. Okay, so if you have an economy which is growing quite a lot, you know, jobs will follow. Okay, and the country will have more jobs. And you know, if the country actually falls into a recession, you know, jobs will be destroyed. And you know, that was the very simple story behind unemployment, no, in economic policy back in the 1980s, early 1990s. Professor Pissarides introduced a couple of concepts which are very important to understand job creation, job destruction, and the phenomenon of unemployment in today's society, which are just two concepts we're not going to deal with, and he should, if he wants, he should delve them. The concept of search, so job creation and job destruction is not just about supply and demand, it's about how people actually look for jobs. There is a search process with frictions in this search process because you have information asymmetries, you don't have perhaps the right skills to work, etc. And also companies that want to hire have the same challenge, okay? And then matching, so search and matching, okay? So in this process of search, your next step is, you know, that the skills and capabilities that companies are expecting from future employees should be found on those future employees. Otherwise, it's going to be a mismatch. And this very simple concept, you know, it's quite reasonable, okay? And we actually can explain many of the things that happen today with technology transition in many industries, applying these concepts that were somehow discovered and were developed and were modeled by Professor Pissarides. So Professor Pissarides is not only an expert on job markets, he's actually one of the leading macroeconomists in Europe and in the world, understanding the combination of fiscal and monetary policy, understanding also the cycles of technology innovation, and job creation and job destruction around technology innovation. And I would like to point out that he's still very active academically. And back in 2018, he set up in London the Institute for the Future of Work. He's very concerned about the impact of technology on work, working conditions, and work of quality. And this is, I think something that defines Professor Pissarides very well. He really wants to understand better real phenomena, not just for the sake of understanding those phenomena deeper, more rationally, but also to try to help solve some big social issues. And just recently, in March this year, this Institute for the Future of Work, in cooperation with the Nuffield Foundation and a few universities, have set up what is called the Pissarides Review on the Future of Work and Well-being, which is, I think, also very important today, not just in terms of the technology disruptions that we're seeing in many industries, obviously energy transition is one of them, but also in terms of this wider phenomenon that we see after COVID that we call the big quit, the big resignation, and how we see that that we are having so much problem getting, you know, employees going back to work. I think that this is a fascinating story. I'm sure that at some point Professor Pissarides will deal with it. Chris, thank you very much for being with us. If I may, just I want also to introduce Mr. Luis de Guindos to you, although most of you know him very well. Luis is currently the Vice President of the European Central Bank, so it's the number two person at the European Central Bank, doing a very important job today, trying not just to fight inflation, but also to make sure that the economy can continue growing and that overseeing the stability of the financial system, in particular of the banking industry. That's very, very important for all of us. Luis was also the Minister for Economic Affairs in the Spanish government between 2011 and 2018. A period of time, especially the first few years, which were, most of us remember those years very well, very tough for the European Union, very tough for Spain in particular. And I can tell you that Luis was key, okay, trying to steer a good long-term orientation for the Spanish economy, trying to implement the right policies in Spain, at the same time trying to sell those policies with his colleagues in the European Union, the European Commission, the Eurozone, the European Central Bank. So he did a fantastic job. Sometimes it was very complex, very difficult, but Luis, no, thank you very much, because I think that many of the good conditions that we still have today in Spain, I think, were laid down in the work that you did back in 2011 through, you know, 2015, 2016. So we have two outstanding speakers. Thank you very much to both of you. And I would like to ask Professor Pissarides to start with his presentation, and then we'll continue with Mr. Luis de Guindos. Thank you very much. Hey, thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Jordi, for that introduction. You really summarized the work well. Better than I could have done after so many years, I think. And I'm really pleased to be here. This is an amazing auditorium. It really inspires you to talk, and it will probably inspire me to talk a lot longer than my allocated time, which is about half an hour, as you can see. I am talking about jobs. Almost everything I talk about nowadays is about jobs. And the emphasis is going to be on green jobs, and that's why I've chosen this background for my slides. I have a habit of putting a little bit too much on the slides. If you can follow my English, it may be a better idea not to try and read them, but of course, you know, they're there, and you're welcome to read them. I'm going to have two main topics that I'm going to talk to you about. The first one is what you see there, that's introductory remarks on the global economy, where we are now, and what's happening in labor markets especially. And that the exciting thing about working in labor markets is that things change, but they change in a sufficiently slow speed that you have time to study them and talk about them. It's not like finance, where you might see something changing today, you prepare a talk, and by tomorrow something completely different has happened and your talk is out of date. So I'm glad I'm not in a business school like this one here, and the finance professor, given what's happening. The labor markets are more subdued, but of course changes do happen. That's my first topic. The second topic is that I'm going to talk more specifically about energy and the energy transition, and where we are, where of course a lot of things are happening now, partly because of the net zero commitment, partly because of the war in Ukraine that's made prices volatile. And the question really is whether we're investing enough to make the transitions that our governments have committed to. Okay, well, first about the introductory remarks. As we all know, we had a pandemic. It was an incredibly unexpected and serious shock to the economy and to labor markets. But a lot of things were happening before the pandemic, and what was happening before the pandemic was a structural change driven by automation technologies, mainly. You know, the World Economic Forum has called it the fourth industrial revolution, where you had each industrial revolution is characterized by one big event, You know, the first one was steam power, the second one was the electric power, the third was computers, and the fourth was robotics and artificial intelligence. It was bringing changes to the labor market, but simultaneously we had globalization, which was not directly, but indirectly related to the new technologies. But globalization was due mainly to the relaxation, to the breaking down of barriers to international trade in the 1980s, and especially the opening up of China. You know, 1.2 billion people suddenly became more active internationally. You would expect to see big things happening. I mean, before the pandemic, we were giving talks saying what big changes are taking place and how are we going to manage those. And suddenly the pandemic comes and it brings another set of very big changes. To the economist, actually, the pandemic was an exciting research topic. It's a little bit sad to say it because, you know, it involved hospitalizations and deaths and so on. But to the economist, it was an exciting topic, and I don't think there has ever been a bigger response to an event by researchers, not only in economics but elsewhere, as with COVID-19. About a year after COVID-19 was identified in the first couple of months of 2020, something like 1,000 economics papers, research papers, were published on COVID, whereas COVID, for the economists, is related to influenza. On influenza, you had something like 3 or 4 papers the previous 20 years, and then another 1,000 in 1 year. And the reason, of course, that the economist finds it like that is that it introduced just one thing into economic relationships, and that's a cost to meeting other people. You know, to the cost is a health cost, but if you're modeling as an economist, you would model it as a downside. You know, like, whereas up to COVID-19, the economists would say meeting other people for exchange, like in my model, which was matching, what you look for is what can you get out of that match. You don't ask, you know, what negative things am I going to get out of that match with someone else. With COVID, you had to take into account the negative thing. Now, in response to that, you would expect trade flows to be badly affected, you would expect production to be badly affected, and you would expect new arrangements coming along in the labor market so that work can be done without people getting close to each other. And that's the pandemic shock that was added onto labor markets, how to organize work in a way that you don't get too close, unnecessarily close to other people. Now, on top of that, as if that wasn't enough, we have the geopolitical developments, mainly two geopolitical developments. In fact, one was the war in Ukraine, Russia's invasion of Ukraine, which impacted mainly energy prices, but also the change of policy in China, which has pursued a very strict lockdown policy, which is still going on and which disrupted supply chains and international trade generally. And despite many promises that openness is important and they're going to open up, of course, they're nowhere near opening up, given what President Xi Jinping said at the last party congress. I have to speed up a little, I can see. Now, what policies do we have to deal with the problem? Well, what we ended up with was inflation because of the expansion of the furlough schemes and the support during COVID. We had stagflation because of the negative things, especially the geopolitical developments. And the monetary and fiscal policy cannot deal with this dual problem easily, but you're going to hear a lot more about this from Mr. De Guindos that is following me, so I will not expand on it. The only thing I would say is that we need not just coordination between monetary and fiscal policy, and governments have been doing it very badly, especially the government of the country that I spend most of my time, which is the United Kingdom. But you also need global coordination in all this, you know, especially United States, European governments should. And that is very difficult. What I'm going to talk more about is micro policies. You also need micro policies to revive the economy. And that's what the labor economy should really be interested in. Now, if you look beyond the very short term, in the medium to longer term, then what drives progress is innovation in new technology. Innovations in agriculture brought the Green Revolution. The industrial revolutions came later, from what I described. There was, in the very, very, very old days, there was the discovery of fire. In fact, I was reading recently that the most important technological innovation that Homo sapiens ever discovered was fire. Without fire, we wouldn't be here, because lions and tigers would have eaten us all, whereas fire saved us. Since then, we had many more when we had steam, electricity, computers, and so on. And each time, of course, that involves big migrations of people, needs for new education. Now, what I'm now more interested in than that, which is the topic of the economy historian, is that industrial revolutions also bring social change. And we get into debates about what's good work, should we be doing this? And that's generally what comes under well-being. And that's the main focus of my project at the Institute for the Future of Work that I was mentioning in the introduction. What is good work? And it's good work where, of course, pay has to be sufficiently good, but there are many, many other features of good work, characterizing good work, that is becoming more and more important in labor markets now. I thought that it was new, but I had one of my PhD students did a search of the literature and discovered that Paul Samuelson, the founder of so many things in economics, actually said in 1970 that that when there is industrial change, then we get momentous social changes that economists should be paying more attention to, and yet that was completely ignored until now, which is sort of 50 years later, as you were. It just shows what pioneers think about. We are still studying what Adam Smith said, for that matter. And what good work is, and this is based on research not only by economists, but also sociologists, psychologists, especially psychologists, actually, but also health researchers, is that they give us a picture of what's good work and what should be aiming for. And the most important feature of what's good work is the principle of engagement of workers in decisions made at work. So you don't have a line manager where he or she tells you what to do, but rather involves you in the decisions made. By that, I don't mean that workers should be sitting at the board of directors. In fact, I don't believe that, because that's not what the comparative advantage is. I don't think it would be a good idea. But what you do have is that you should be having more information exchange. They should be giving more autonomy to the worker within the broader framework of company objectives. There should be informal interaction with line managers. There should be away weekends, whatever, from work. That's what motivates people, and that's what brings more satisfaction from work and even higher productivity. There are other things, of course, fair pay, equal treatment across workers of gender, sexual orientation, race, and all that are important. People pay attention to those things. Social support, health, safety, psychological well-being, especially after COVID, are becoming very important. And job design, there's now a specialist occupation, which is a job designer. How can you design a job to give incentives to the worker to enjoy the work? Does it enable you to balance better work and family life? And that, of course, applies mainly to the participation of women in the labor force, which is still an untapped resource, especially in Europe, Southern Europe, in fact, especially. So all those things is what's now happening in research on labor markets, and what we're focusing on, how to provide those, how to advise employers, if you like, to be pay more attention to those things. And at the same time, we still have artificial intelligence taking place. Now, of course, AI technologies and automation technologies have the ability to replace labor, but they also have the ability to improve the quality of work. And we see more and more applications of the quality of work. They are spreading very fast in labor markets by labor market standards, not by finance economics standards. Up to now, the fastest innovations were always related to health. I think the record of the fastest application up to digital technologies belonged to the stent, the heart treatment, which is something like seven, between discovery and widespread use in all major hospitals of the world, it took something like 7 years. Smartphone, some people don't consider it to be a major innovation because we had mobile phones before. But the smartphone took about, 1 year for everyone to have an iPhone or something, you know, like it was introduced in 2007, and by 2010, I think the majority of people had one. So that's much faster spreading. What's important with AI is that we do have a choice on how to use it. You could use AI for peaceful purposes, to improve the quality of work, to improve the quality of life, to improve health standards, or you could use it to fight wars more effectively, and it's really our choice how to do it. I think, in fact, with AI, we have a lot more choice than previous technologies. I mean, just think of electricity. How much choice did we have in the application of electricity? It's what Americans call a no-brainer. You know, if you have horses and steam power and so on, driving your machines and yourself, and suddenly someone offers you electricity, of course you're going to take it. You're just going to substitute it. But with AI, it's not as straightforward as that. It's a lot more choice. And what's rather sad about it is that we still don't have a means on. We still don't know how to think about AI. I've just read an interesting book by Henry Kissinger and Eric Schmidt about AI, and a computer expert actually from MIT, his name I can't remember. And essentially, I don't know if you've seen it. Essentially, what they're saying is that we know how to control nuclear weapons because we can count them, and you have secret services knowing exactly how much Russia has and how much China has and how much America has. We have no way of controlling AI because we don't know how much there is. And there is no way, we don't have a way of knowing how much it is. So if someone wants to abuse it, they can do it. But if someone, and there is fear that at least someone is thinking of how to do it. Whereas, and equally, if we knew how to handle it well, we could be handling it well to improve the quality of life and improve health standards and the quality of work, which is another thing that is sort of occupying me now. If you don't mind losing at chess, you can play with it because AlphaZero has not been defeated yet by anyone. But that's easy compared with the alternatives that AI could have. I mean, it's not easy for me, but it's easy for the algorithms to show you how you play chess. All right, now we move to energy. I've talked a little bit too much already about the introductions, but I find them fascinating. Now we move to energy and the green transition in energy. Here you might agree or disagree with me, but we'll wait and see, and we can discuss it later. Now, the energy sector, of course, it was undergoing the same structural transformations because of automation technologies as everything else. It would be a big surprise if it wasn't. Now, on top of that, it has the green transition commitments. And the way I see this, partly as an outsider, if you like, into the energy sector, is that why not try and use the new technologies, AI and automation technologies, to achieve a better green transition and to improve the quality that the service the energy sector is offering. And in fact, in a previous conversation, early conversation you had, you dropped the name of a company that is doing this, and I looked it up, and it's spot on here, but I don't know if you want me to mention company names, so I will not. No, right. And of course, Naturgy is doing it, and that's why you mentioned it. So that name we can mention. Now, the commitments we have, of course, is that energy for industry buildings is, the green term, the commitment we have in Paris to 2015, for example, which is net zero emissions by 2050, is where should we focus? Well, the energy industry accounts for about 3/4 of greenhouse emissions, so that's obviously where the focus has to be. What do we have in their place? Obviously, sustainable sources of energy, which is essential. Now, to achieve the maximum 1.5 global warming objective, wind and solar powers need to increase sevenfold by 2030. I mean, 2030 is only, 8 years away, seven and a half. And about half of that overall transition should be completed by 2030. At least that's what I read the experts are saying. Now, looking at it from the point of view of investments and what's happening in jobs and all that, is that although investment in fossil fuels is falling in response to that, investment in greener forms of energy is not nearly as much as is needed to replace it. So we're going to have a problem if we carry on in this way. And what I'm calling a silver lining there is that maybe the change in the cost of energy because of geopolitical developments is a kind of silver lining in the sense that there is a bigger incentive to accelerate the transition than what was happening before. What we've learned, as if we didn't know, is that energy touches all sectors of the economy, and that's why we're observing a general inflation rather than a change in relative prices, which is what the original shock was. You're going to hear more about that in a minute. Since that's the case, the transition to green energy needs investments and changes across the whole economy, not just in one sector. It needs changes both in the household sector and the firm sector. So what do these transitions imply for labor markets? So let's look at the labor market transitions necessitated by that. First, we need both government and companies need to spend more on investing in the transition to new forms of energy. It will have direct jobs in that it will create jobs, but it will have indirect positive shocks through multiplier effects. I think the multiplier effects have been exaggerated in the literature, but they might be positive or they might be close to zero. What is certainly the case, though, is that in the beginning, at least, when the transition is taking place, which should be current, there will be more jobs created than what will be needed in the longer term, and there will certainly be more jobs created than will be destroyed in brown jobs. Given that labor markets are rather tight now, this may not be easy to achieve, in fact. It's going to be a challenge to find all the workers that you need to, I'm using as an example, to install photovoltaics, do wind generations, and so on. In other words, the transitional phase is going to be much more labor intensive than when we reach a green steady state, how many people are needed to maintain that technology. And that's something to bear in mind, that where are those workers going to come from? You know, it's it might be related to immigration, but there aren't enough workers to do that now, currently with the situation where in Spain might be an exception because you still have high unemployment, but the unemployment in the rest of Europe is about 3-4%, which is about as low as it can get. We also know that even in a steady state, the green forms of energy are more labor intensive than the fossil fuel forms. In other words, we don't have automation technologies for green sources of energy as yet, to the extent that we have them the sort of dirty fuels, if you like, that we have now. And as a result, the transition to new forms of energy is not going to cause any unemployment. In fact, if anything, it's going to make labor markets more tight. It's going to increase the demand for labor. Now, of course, another way of looking at it, which always like it, is that it's not going to be good for productivity either. If you are looking for technologies to increase your productivity in the energy sector, by going green, you're going to reduce your productivity because you'll need per euro of energy that you create, you're going to need more workers. I don't think that's a problem. I think in Europe we have sufficiently high productivity to be paying attention to other things, but politicians always like to pay attention to productivity. In Britain, there is the most money spent on economic research is what they call the productivity puzzle. What they call a puzzle is low UK productivity. You know, I mean, I know enough British workers to realize that it's not a puzzle that they are not productive, but the politicians don't live in the same environment, I suspect. Now, the other thing is that greener forms of energy, like photovoltaics, electric cars, home insulation, they are better jobs than what we have now. So I talked before about the good jobs and the importance to pay attention to well-being at work. Well, in greener forms of energy, we have that. We should be aiming for better. And the Institute for the Energy Association, maybe, no. I can't remember what A stands for, but it's an energy institute anyway. They estimate that 75% of new jobs created will require higher skills, and there will be better quality jobs than what we have now. You know, they are not concentrated in dirty factory environments. They are not in extraction like coal, and they could be structured in a way that they become a lot more attractive. And it's important to do that because you'll be able to attract the workers, and especially the untapped labor pools like the female labor force or older ages should be able to work in green forms of energy in the way that they cannot do it with fossil fuel extraction and development. So new jobs will be created in within existing companies in manufacturing, some replacing old and some new. I mentioned that there will be changes throughout industrial employment. We do need to have more startups. Battery production and development is, I think, is absolutely essential and is still not where it should be, even for Tesla, from what I was hearing recently. Job destruction, however, will mainly take place in fossil fuel industries, and there will be a structural change going from brown jobs to green jobs because of the changes taking place. And although, I don't know if that's on the slide, yeah, although that looks like it's forbidding if you are in a company like Naturgy, because you are directly involved, if you look at the bigger picture, it's not really very much. The jobs that will be destroyed will be less than 1% of total employment. And the jobs that will be created might be a little bit more than 1% of total employment. So in terms of numbers, we are not talking about anything very serious. The only serious situations that arise is when you look at the geographic mismatch and the industrial mismatch that you might have, in that some sectors of the economy, like production of gas, coal, fossil fuels, could lose 40% of employment. Others could gain up to 40% of employment. These are estimates by the OECD. And that's astonishingly how difficult sometimes it is for that. You know, for example, in Britain, the coal mines closed in the 1980s under Thatcher. It was Thatcher who closed the coal mines. South Wales was an area that was fairly well off. It was the main coal mining area, and it was completely destroyed, including massive tragic accidents, in fact, from coal. And even now, it's still the poorest part of the United Kingdom because they lost the coal mines in 40 years ago. It takes very long to adjust. So that's going to be the biggest mismatch. I mean, that's a classic case of geographical mismatch. You have Welsh boys and girls going to school, getting educated like the rest, and although some of them are leaving, their own, they cannot generate activity within their own area for having lost the coal mines 40 years ago. Newcastle is another example like that. You know, the saying used to be, bring coal to Newcastle, meaning you're giving where there is abundance. And Newcastle is the, for the size of the city, is the poorest city in the United Kingdom still. The biggest investment that's taken in Newcastle was the football club from Saudi Arabians recently. I mean, like, that is serious. You know, you shouldn't dismiss that as something that doesn't matter. But the economy as a whole, though, it's not going to be affected. So that's the points that I'm making here about the mismatch that's taking place. Let's move on. Now, I don't know how long do you want me to spend. I think there is another 10 minutes, maybe. Should I speed up? Yes. All right. Okay. Now these are probably things you know. Actually, they were just there, and I put them there. That the eco industries that produce the green jobs are in pollution management will be important. Resources management, but even those in advanced economies, they employ less than 2% of workers, so it's not a serious. Now, how important is it to know the numbers? There's always discussion, how do we define green jobs? How do we define brown jobs? There are different definitions by ILO, OECD, Europe. I don't think it's more important, it's very important. The reason, what's more important is that we should bear in mind that the demand for labor is what economists call the derived demand, which means that it comes from what consumers and producers want. And the main thing in this transition is not so much to persuade companies to switch and use green jobs. The main thing is to educate consumers, who is the final user, that to switch to greener forms of energy and switch to products that are produced with greener forms of energy. And then producers will follow, because producers are aiming to satisfy as much the demand of consumers so that they can, so that their company can flourish. Now, again, maybe not surprising that the sectors that cause 90% of pollution employ only about 14% of the labor force, and that's where, when they're replaced by greener sectors, they will be employing more than 14% of workers. You know, like there's heavy concentration of pollution in non-labor intensive sectors. Finally, I just say a few things about new skill requirements. The new skills required actually they are not very very different from what we have now. It should be very easy to train workers in the new forms. I just got a quotation from John Kerry, who was in charge of these transitions in the United States, who said it's the biggest economic transformation since the Industrial Revolution. I think that's just the vast exaggeration. It's not the biggest transformation. It's something that countries could just routinely take on. Every year we have transformations of that kind. It is a transformation, but it's not massive. Now most of the attention is on the digital transformation, and most policies, green environmental transformations, are taking second place. I think there should be a re-weighting because we need to pay more attention in the schools, universities, and so forth in research. We need to direct more R&D in this. The R&D, again, is directed to digital technologies and what to do with AI, rather than using AI specifically in the greener sectors. But as I mentioned, skills are not very serious. We can take that later in discussion if there is interest, since we are, no, let me skip that. And finally, as something that is being talked about most of all is the revenue recycling, what people sometimes call the double dividend. You can switch taxes from labor to environmental issues. Sweden has been using a very innovative tax in this respect, and Canada, you would expect on things like that, actually, that the Swedes would be leading the rest of the Europeans, and they are, even in this. And governments need to do more on infrastructure to enable the greener forms of energy. You know, you still see, even in the unfortunate Liz Truss government, the big commitment of the business secretary was to go back to fracking and extraction of oil rather than green forms. I mean, that obviously is not very helpful, but it only lasted about 2 weeks in the job. And finally, the good jobs should be inclusive, both within and between. And as I was saying, we now have the possibility to make the energy transition into more inclusive type of jobs. Now it's completely dominated by men, I think, whereas the new jobs will be better jobs, and if we structure them correctly, we'll be able to attract workers that have been left out of the labor force. And here it is. Yeah, I'm sorry about the end taking longer, but the main point I wanted to make was that the energy sector is both at the center of digital and environmental transformations, but you could use the digital technology to achieve a better environmental transformation. And the job destruction needed is only slightly bigger than in other sectors of the economy. It's not easy to achieve. New technologies are more labor intensive, and the only thing to pay attention to really is the concentration of these jobs in certain sectors of the country, in many countries. And I've used coal mining as the best example, but there are others. And thank you very much for listening to me, and I'm sorry it's taken longer. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chris, for this excellent lecture. Very clear, very well structured. We understand why he is such a distinguished professor of economics and a Nobel Prize Award winner. I mean, he's able to distill and present complex issues in a very, very simple, very comprehensive way. Perhaps I would like to highlight a couple of dimensions, and perhaps in the dialogue at the end of the session, we'll have more opportunities. But I would like to point out, first thing is that we speak a lot about energy transition, which is very important. I think that his perspective of trying to understand energy transition as one more technology transition, I think is very relevant, because we don't have a lot of experience in energy transition, but we do have a lot of experience. I mean, humanity and social scientists and policymakers on governing other technology transitions. And I think it's very, very important, okay, to try to learn from other types of technology transitions that we've seen in the past, that we're currently seeing today in some industries, to really try to understand what may happen with energy transition. And then the second message, which I think is quite, I would say, optimistic, and I think it's always good to have some data to base upon our acts of optimism, okay, which is, look, in terms of jobs, okay, this is not a huge challenge, okay, for the energy industry. I think that this is very important. We do have a challenge, obviously, as Professor Pissarides pointed out, some sectors in the energy industry will fall down in terms of activity, in terms of number of jobs, but you know, the numbers are not that big, first thing, and second, there are new jobs being created around green energy. And I think that's very important. The point here, and I would like to introduce it, it's It's this touchy issue of search and matching, okay? Because it's how we train the new generation of employees, of workers, okay, who will be able to actually provide professional services in this new emerging green energy industry. So thank you very much, Chris. We'll continue the dialogue around these and other issues. And I would like to ask Luis de Guindos now to take the ground and to help us consider the financial implications of this process of energy transition. Thank you. Thank you, Luis.
Buenos días a todo el mundo. Good morning, everyone. Let me start, if I may, saying some words in Spanish. I think that is quite convenient, taking into consideration that we are in Madrid. Muchísimas gracias al IESE, a Naturgy, por esta invitación, por hacerlo con el profesor Pissarides, contigo, Jordi. Es siempre un placer estar aquí. Y para hablar de algo que es especialmente relevante, es el impacto de la energía en la economía, que siempre ha sido importante, siempre ha sido intenso, pero especialmente en estos momentos. I will turn back to English. I will focus my remarks on three issues. The first one is the outlook, the present situation, the potential evolution and the feasible evolution of growth and inflation. Second, the monetary policy decisions that we have taken recently. And finally, I will take into consideration the impact of energy price developments on inflation before discussing the green transition and how climate change is taken into account in our monetary policy framework. Starting with the outlook. As you know, growth in the euro area is estimated to have slowed down significantly in the third quarter of this year, with real GDP growing at a rate of 0.2%. High inflation continues to dampen spending and production throughout our economies. Severe disruptions in the supply gas have worsened the situation further, and both consumer and business confidence have fallen rapidly. Demand for services is decelerating following the strong rebound that came with the reopening of the economy over the summer, especially in tourism. The continued weakening in global demand, also in the context of tighter monetary policy in many major economies, and the worsening terms of trade mean that there is less support for the euro area economy. Inflation continued to rise, reaching 10.7% in October, driven by further increases in all its main components. Supply bottlenecks have eased, but their impact is still gradually feeding through the consumer prices, as is the impact of pent-up demand in the services sector. The depreciation of the euro has also added to the build-up of inflationary pressures. Price pressures are evident in more and more sectors, in part owing to the impact of high energy costs feeding through to the whole economy. More than half of the items in the harmonized index of consumer prices have recorded inflation rates above 4%. And measures of underlying inflation have remained at elevated levels. In particular, inflation excluding energy and food rose further to 5% in October. To support the timely return to inflation to our 2% medium-term target, our monetary policy aims to reduce support for demand and to ensure that inflation expectations remain anchored at our target. Last week, we decided to raise the three key ECB interest rates by 75 basis points, the third major rate hike in a row. And we expect to raise interest rates further. We also changed the terms and conditions of the third series of targeted long-term financing operations, what we call TLTRO III, to ensure that this calibration is consistent with the broader monetary policy normalization process and to reinforce the transmission of our policy rate increases to bank lending conditions. Finally, we decided to set the remuneration of minimum reserves held by credit institutions in the balance sheet of the Eurosystem at a rate and in the present circumstances at a rate of the deposit facility rate that we have now in place, in order to better reflect the rate that at which funds can be invested in money markets instruments or borrowed in money markets to fulfill minimum reserves. But let me return to inflation and its components. Energy price inflation at close to 42% in October remained the dominant driver of overall inflation. It caused a pronounced rise in inflation in the course of 2021 and at the beginning of 2022. While the initial rise in energy prices was driven mainly by the recovery in energy demand, as lockdown measures were eased, the subsequent price rally during 2021 was also significantly influenced by supply-side issues and later exacerbated by the Russian invasion of Ukraine. European gas prices have increased particularly sharply since the summer of 2021. This reflects a combination of supply and demand factors that left European gas inventories at historically low levels, and the gas market vulnerable to supply and demand uncertainty. As a result, consumer gas and electricity prices, both driven by natural gas prices, have played an increasingly important role in energy inflation dynamics. European gas spot prices have dropped strongly over recent weeks, owing to a variety of factors. These include weakening gas demand due to the mild near-term weather forecast, high storage levels, and a higher supply of liquefied natural gas and pipeline gas from Norway, as well as initiatives at national and EU level to curb gas demand, support supply, and cap prices. However, the drop in gas future prices has remained much more contained than the drop in the spot prices, suggesting that the supply situation is still very fragile. Looking further ahead, while supply bottlenecks are expected to ease further, the energy shock is expected to increasingly weigh on activity and inflation. Rising energy prices are expected to squeeze real disposable income and dampen production. At the same time, the as yet incomplete pass-through of wholesale energy prices to consumer prices, as well as recent geopolitical events, point to continuing upward pressures to the inflation energy component. The unprecedented energy price developments and the ensuing energy crisis are posing challenges in various ways. In fact, a trade-off between energy security, the green transition, and price stability may be emerging. Despite the current monetary policy challenges, the ECB is seriously committed to doing its part to address climate change and promote the green transition, as this is necessary to fulfill our price stability objective. Climate change can have an impact on macroeconomic indicators, the stability of the financial system, and the transmission of monetary policy. All these channels affect the outlook for price stability. Climate change also has a bearing on the ECB's own risk management. Our monetary policy operations have encompassed asset purchases, as you know perfectly, which now appear on the Eurosystem's balance sheet. Counterparties to our lending operations must pledge assets as collateral against the money they borrow from us. We need to consider the impact of climate change on the value and the risk profile of these assets to ensure that it does not jeopardize the achievement of our monetary policy objectives. Furthermore, without prejudice to our primary goal of safeguarding price stability, a secondary objective of the ECB is to support general economic policies in the Union, in the European Union. This includes a high level of protection and improvement of the quality of the environment, in line with the EU's climate neutrality objectives. This means that if faced with a choice between two policy options that have a comparable impact on price stability, we should choose the option that better supports the secondary objective. In the strategy review we completed last year, we committed to including climate change considerations in our monetary policy operations. More concretely, we have decided first to adjust corporate bond holdings in our monetary policy portfolios. Second, limit the share of assets issued by non-financial companies with a high carbon footprint and that can be pledged as collateral by individual counterparties. Third, introduce climate-related disclosure requirements in our collateral framework. And finally, enhance our risk assessment and management. The aim is to gradually decarbonize our corporate bond holdings on a path aligned with the goals of the Paris Agreement. In practice, this involves measuring the climate performance of each eligible issuer based on its greenhouse gas emissions, carbon reduction targets, and climate-related disclosures. Ultimately, this will result in the purchase of more bonds issued by companies with a good climate performance and fewer bonds from those with a poor climate performance. This tilting changes the composition of the monetary policy portfolio, but the overall purchase volume is still determined solely by monetary policy considerations, in line with our primary target, that is price stability. This process is already underway. As of October the 1st, we have started to tilt our investment purchases towards issuers with a better climate performance. And from the first quarter of 2023, we will start to publish climate-related information on our corporate bond holdings. To enhance our risk assessment and risk management, the ECB is conducting a climate stress test on the Eurosystem balance sheet, starting with the corporate holdings to be finalized in the first half of next year. Let me conclude. The current energy crisis has left Europe at a crossroads, presenting challenging challenges as well as opportunities for the green transition. The Russian invasion of Ukraine and the subsequent reduction of fossil fuel supplies have imposed a potential trade-off between energy security, the green transition, and price stability. With inflation currently at very elevated levels and expected to stay above our target for an extended period, monetary policy must remain focused on reducing support for demand and guarding against the risk of persistent upward shift in inflation expectations. The longer inflation levels stay above our target, the greater the risk of second-round effects through wage increases or the anchoring of inflation expectations. Amid the present uncertainty, future decisions on policy rates will continue to be data-dependent and follow a meeting-by-meeting approach. To keep the green transition on track, concrete policy actions are needed to make the most of the opportunities provided by the current energy crisis. Expanding the share of renewable energy supplies would reduce dependency on fossil fuels. It would also benefit price stability, given the declining prices for renewable energy observed in the last decades. In addition, to bring down energy costs sustainably over the medium term, governments should act to dismantle the regulatory barriers preventing the uptake of renewable energy, prioritize upgrading the electricity grid, and foster investment in renewables. An important role for fiscal policy is to support the green transition via public green investment. To counter the sharp rise in energy prices, many governments have adopted expensive and broad-based support measures for households and firms. But these measures risk diluting relative price signals that are crucial to incentivize energy saving and foster green investment. Instead, government support should be, as we have indicated many times, temporary and targeted towards vulnerable households and firms. This would also help to limit risks to fiscal sustainability in the medium term. Fiscal policy and monetary policy need to work hand in hand. In view of the normalization of monetary policy, it is essential to achieve a good balance between supporting energy security and ensuring price stability while keeping the green transition on track. Thank you very much. Muchas gracias.
Well, thank you very much, Luis, for this very clear, very well-structured presentation on the views of ECB and monetary policy, inflation, and also energy transition and climate change. So it's, I think it's a very good complement to what Chris Pissarides just said on energy transition and jobs. I would like to ask Chris if you want to make any comment on the macro considerations on energy transition, any comment on monetary policy and the combination with fiscal policy, and what Luis de Guindos just said.
I agree entirely, actually, with this evaluation that when it comes to fighting the inflation, I think monetary and fiscal policy should coordinate, which they are not doing very well. But of course, the reason they are not doing it very well is that is that it's difficult to see how to do it, because it's not since the 70s did we have such a difficult situation where there's a combination of a change in the relative price of something that affects production across the board and consumption at home, which is energy, and at the same time we had the excess liquidity in the market that governments very rightly provided during the pandemics. When it comes to the green transition, though, I don't think monetary policy, quite honestly, I don't think monetary policy should be paying attention to it. I mean, I have seen a lot of demands from green, you know, Greenpeace and other groups saying that central banks have a role in the green transition, in that they shouldn't support banks that invest in dirty forms of energy, with which I have sympathy if they can differentiate between them. But beyond that, though, I think it's fiscal policy that should be addressing and giving incentives for the green transition in the form of taxes on polluting industries, carbon emissions, and so forth, and then using that revenue to recycle into giving incentives for greener forms of energy. And so overall, I think we should draw a distinction between the what's going on to fight inflation now, which I agree, the biggest risk that we should stop is for inflation to become built into expectations, because we have one previous example of what happened when in the 70s we allowed inflation to be built into expectations, and we had the famous or infamous Volcker deflation, which of course devastated macroeconomics for a few years, including Europe and United States, but it was necessary looking back. It prepared the ground for Greenspan to come in and take all the glory. but that's what I wanted to say.
Luis, I don't know if you want to comment a bit more on this.
Well, I think that, you know, first of all, and I think that it was implicit in my initial remarks, I would like to underscore two factors. The first one is the impact of energy in inflation. The impact that energy is having on services and goods. It's not only, you know, the weight of energy in the basket of goods and services of the inflation index. Indirectly, energy has a negative impact on services, on goods that are an important part of the basket of the index. So perhaps, you know, sometimes we are underestimating the real impact of energy on inflation. Mm-hmm. Recently, because you have the direct impact, that is the one that we refer continuously. This is the, you know, this 42% that is around one half of the increase in inflation recently. But simultaneously, you have an indirect impact on services and goods. That because, well, you know, if you can imagine, for instance, hospitality, restaurants, hotels. Indirectly, energy is having an impact on the price of these industries, on these sectors. So that's the first aspect that we have to take into consideration, that energy is feeding not only through the weight of energy in the basket, but indirectly as well through other kind of channels that affect the rest of the goods and services of the index. And the second aspect that I would like to stress is, and that it has been as well something mentioned by Professor Pissarides, now is who is responsible for the green transition. Let me say very clearly here that the first line of defense are governments. Governments, they have fiscal policy, they can put in place taxes, they can incentivize different sources of energy. So that's the first line of defense. In the case of central banks, in the case of the ECB, our mandate is very clear, is price stability, something that I have stressed several times in my initial remarks. But climate transition and the energy transition is going to have an impact on the outlook is going to have an impact on price stability, directly or indirectly. So it's something that we have to take into consideration. And secondly, and this is something that I also indicated, you know, in my remarks, even though price stability is the first mandate and our you know, very clearly in the treaty that we have to be focused on price stability, it's quite clear that we have to contribute as well to other kind of policies that now, you know, are high in the agenda of the European Union. Digitalization, for instance, is one, and the other one is the green transition. So if we are continuously, you know, when we are deciding about our policies, not only interest rates, but we are analyzing, you know, other kind of actions in our monetary policy toolkit, when we have, you know, two actions that are identical in terms of the potential impact on inflation, if one of them is more positive in terms of the climate change, we have to go for that. So this is something that indirectly, you know, we can make an important contribution. And finally, if you look at the balance sheet of the ECB, the balance sheet of the ECB is not small. It's more than €7 trillion. And so we have a lot of bonds, government bonds, public sector securities, but we have a lot of corporate bonds. And so we have started to take into consideration climate change considerations when we assess the solvency and the quality of the assets that we are buying. Now we are not buying anything, but we are continuously reinvesting, you know, the maturities of the bonds that we have in our balance sheet so far. And this is another dimension that I think that is important, that we can make a contribution. And trying to facilitate the disclosure of the issuers of the different securities in terms of climate change, how they are fighting climate change. So these are, two considerations that I think that is important to underline.
Thank you, Luis. Before we move to the audience with questions, I would like to perhaps keep digging on this issue of fiscal policy. And I would like to ask you, Chris, we're seeing a reaction by different European governments facing this energy crisis and trying to somehow offset the distributional effects of the increase in energy prices and inflation. And we see a variety of reactions by different European governments. Some governments are using across the board subsidies for every single citizen, just, you know, subsidizing the price of gas of in oil stations, or subsidizing other forms of energy consumption for all citizens. Other governments are adopting other policies. From your perspective, what should be more efficient in terms of actually adjusting consumption, energy consumption, to this new reality of prices in energy markets on the one hand, and also how to take care of these distributional effects in the best possible way, how to handle efficiency and the equity dimensions in this current situation?
Well, I mean, what's happening with energy now is that there is an external shock that increased the energy prices, you know, to go more on the distributional issue. And it cannot be avoided, you know, because it's coming from outside. The whole of the European Union is coming outside of our individual countries. Someone was supplying energy and is saying, now I want to be paid more for that energy. It's a little bit like OPEC before and now because of the war. Now, what do you do on the distributional? It becomes more a kind of social, political decision rather than purely economic. The only thing and of course that's up to the government. You know, I mean, I know what I would support, and that's certainly not what the British government has done, for example, which decided to compensate the high-income households more than compensating low-income households. The only comment I would say on the distribution, and that's another project that I started recently with another company, actually, that we have enough data now, the kind of big data, quote unquote, as it's called, on households, which derives mainly from social media, not social media, but platforms, like retail platforms, you know, like Amazon, Alibaba in China, and so on, that also the tax information, which is digital, that government should be better at targeting support than doing it across the board. And I don't know why they don't do it. In fact, we just started, as I was saying, a project with a company in Britain that we're calling quantum governance, you know, going into quantum, into individual small units, and target them. And I think that will improve efficiency enormously as well if you use big data to target individuals. It should be very easy. You know, I mean, we know that we are all being monitored, for example, by the tax authorities using the big data that they have on us. Why, and that's to catch us out if we try and cheat. Why don't they use the same information to help us out when we need help? You know, like, Britain is spending an enormous amount of money on supporting energy, and they're either doing it same across the board. They're doing it through energy companies. You know, even the energy bills that we get have a deduction from the bill that the company sends us. And it says government support for energy this year, deduct it and do it. And absolutely everyone does it. Everyone gets it. It's costing something like £40 billion. In fact, it's the big thing that might disturb financial markets again, in that they're putting so much money in without extra taxation. Why should they do it like that? You know, why don't they give it only to the bottom 10%, 20% of incomes rather than higher? That's what I don't understand. It wasn't easy in the old days. Now, admittedly, with the exception of Luis, of course, ministers are not very digitally expert now. I don't know if you ever used digital. I guess it was before the digital revolution, really, that you were in power. But I mean, I don't know. You know, it's ridiculous to have lawyers in charge of ministries of finance, for example, now. I mean, you know, technology has moved on. Use it to improve the efficiency of the country. Not to satisfy your party commitments to such and such. You know, I mean, our last prime minister was training classics, Rome and Greece. Is it surprising that he was kicked out eventually? I mean, like, anyway, don't get me going on about British politics.
Very good. Chris, do you want to make any additional comment on fiscal policy or?
Well, I think that the question of the policy mix is key. I think that there is a big difference with respect to the situation that we had during the pandemic. During the pandemic, monetary policy was extremely accommodative, and fiscal policy was in a whatever it takes mood. And so those times, and I think that it was a success when you look at you know, how rapidly the European economy recovered from the shock of the health shock of Corona. I think that you know, we should be satisfied with you know, the way that the policy mix was implemented, but now it's different. And the difference, and the main difference, is inflation. Inflation was very low during the pandemic, even we were very close to zero, and now inflation is above 10% in the euro area. So monetary policy has to normalize. And simultaneously, when you look at fiscal policy, the fiscal profile of different countries, mainly of the usual suspects of Southern Europe, have deteriorated. We have more debt, we have bigger structural deficits. So we have to change in comparison with the situation that we had during the pandemic in 2020 and 2021. And this takes me to the question of you know, of how fiscal policy should be implemented in an energy shock. I fully agree with Professor Pissarides that you know, it cannot be across the board. It cannot be, you know, I think that many of the measures that have been taken by the governments, and I think that this is a study of the European Fiscal Board. 80% of all the measures, I think that in that respect, the UK and the European Union are quite similar, are totally undiscriminated. They are not tailor-made. Because I fully agree that measures should be targeted to the low-income group, to the vulnerable groups, that they are suffering much more than the average, the consequence of the energy shock and the consequence of inflation. And whereas for governments, whatever the reason, I think that perhaps, you know, it's because the implementation is much more difficult and to put in place is much more complicated. In some countries you have a subsidy per liter of diesel or petrol at the pump. So for everybody, for rich people, for poor people, and it's not going to be cheap. I can assure you. So I would be in favor of having, you know, much more focused fiscal policy, in order not only, you know, to. I think that the kind of incentives that we have to put in place should not eliminate the price signal, because if we subsidize the price, perhaps what we are doing at the end of the day to slow down the energy transition that we need, and we are slowing down the very, very needed reduction of the dependency of fossil fuels from Russia, delivered by Russia. So I think that it should be much more targeted in terms of the incomes and the revenues of these low-income vulnerable groups of the society that Professor Pissarides has indicated before, the bottom. So I think that this is a discussion from a political standpoint is not easy, because the implementation of the measure is much more difficult, but I think that it would be much more effective. It would not hinder the needed green transition, and it could give rise to a much better outcome at the end of the day.
Thank you. Thank you, Luis. Well, as you can imagine, the discussion that we have been following by Professor Pissarides and Luis de Guindos has generated lots of questions here. I've been trying to group together some questions under some categories. My apologies if I'm not able to read all the questions, because I counted 45 questions on paper, and I think I have 10 online, so too many, we won't have time. So my apologies for those of you who actually put a question and it was not actually addressed. So I'll try to group and ask the questions by what I understand, more or less, order of, I would say, higher interest, because of the number of questions around the same topic. The first is for Luis de Guindos. Luis, there are a number of questions here on inflation, and some questions that actually ask the perspective that you have, that the ECB has, on how much of the current inflation rate is due to supply factors, especially energy factors, and how much is demand driven by pent-up demand after the pandemic. Any comments on this?
Well, we have analyzed the evolution of the index of inflation, and first of all, because we have underestimated, as everybody else, we have underestimated inflation over the last year and a half. So we have made mistakes, as everybody has made mistakes, with respect to the forecasted inflation and our projections about inflation. When you analyze the evolution of inflation over the last 18 months, the conclusion that you reach is that approximately two-thirds of the increase in inflation, increase in prices, response is the consequence is driven by the energy shock and supply side considerations, and one third because of the pent up demand that was accumulated during the time of the pandemics and the increase in demand when economies started to reopen after the third wave or the fourth wave of the pandemic. So there is a demand component mainly in services. Something that is quite visible, the evolution of tourism in the third quarter of this year all over Europe. So there is a supply side component and a demand component. and a demand component that is especially relevant for services. So many people say, well, then if it is supply side, you are not going to, you know, the ECB or the Federal Reserve, you are not going to have an impact on energy prices if you raise rates. That's right, but we cannot overlook that there is a demand component having an impact on services. And second, let me stress something that in my view is relevant. Is monetary policy is about credibility at the end of the day. Credibility that you will be able to bring back to your definition of price stability, the evolution of inflation, the evolution of prices. If we lose credibility, then immediately we will have two consequences. The first one will be at the anchoring of inflation expectations, and related to that, we will start to have second round effects. And that could give rise to a spiral of wages and other kind of nominal incomes and prices that could be extremely detrimental. It could be back. It could be something similar to what happened in the 70s. Well, in the 70s, we have to remember that Volcker fought inflation, increasing rates until to a level that was, totally, impossible today, but close to 20%. And let me say something additional in that respect. When you analyze, because now we have, this sort of debate between recession, inflation, what's going to be, the leading force in over the next months. My personal view is that over the next months, we are going to have very low growth in the euro area. I refer to the euro area. I do not dismiss the possibility of having a technical recession. I think that perhaps in the fourth quarter, quarter-on-quarter growth will be negative, and perhaps as well in the first quarter of 2023. And simultaneously, inflation will be very high, will continue being very high. Our projections is that inflation will be hovering around the present levels until year end. Next year, it will start to decline, but it will continue, being clearly above 2%. I would say that in the first half of 2023, perhaps inflation will be in the area on average around 6-7%. So it's extremely high and extremely above our projection, our definition of price stability. And perhaps, one of the main factors behind the slowdown of the economy is inflation. Inflation is denting the disposable income, the real disposable income of households. Inflation as well is making capital expenditure allocation much more complex, because when you have high inflation, the signals of the markets start to be blurred. And we have to take into consideration that on top of this high inflation, we have a lot of uncertainty because of the war, because of the situation in Europe, and this kind of things. So inflation is dampening aggregate demand, and is dampening growth. So, and this is perhaps something that sometimes, because they say, some people say, if you increase interest rates, you are going to aggravate the recession. I would say, if we do not be able to rein in inflation, then the outlook for growth will be much worse. So that's the approach of the ECB. We are fully committed to reduce inflation. We will continue with our monetary policy actions in order to reduce inflation. That is our primary target. But as well, because this is the way forward in order to have a recovery in the medium term.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Luis. Chris, there are a few questions here on energy transition and the analogy to other technology disruptions that we've seen over the past decades. Actually, a couple of questions point out something which I think it's an interesting insight, which is, I don't read the questions because they're a bit long, but the idea is, look, in other technology disruptions, we may know the final stage, the final, I would say, dominant model of technology that could, in energy transition, we do not know which dominant model we will have. The role, of wind and solar energy certainly is going to be important, but there is the technology issue here around energy storage that actually those two modalities of energy generation actually need. then the future of hydrogen, the future of simplified form of nuclear energy. So there are a number of uncertainties here on this energy transition. Do you have any suggestion, any model to think about whether a government should foster competition among these different types of with the problem that if governments foster competition, resource allocation will be more complex, okay, and probably will be less abundant, or governments should actually pick up one or two or three of them and say, look, this is the horizon that we want to have in Europe for the next 50 years. What's your feeling about it? Because this is certainly one of the major uncertainties, especially for companies, energy companies and other companies, in actually walking down the pathway of energy transition.
Well, given the way that we do politics and the and what we believe in Europe, in democracy, freedom of speech, you know, to live your life without too much government interference, other than social support to low-income households, which I think is absolutely essential. I don't think government should dictate what kind of technologies we have. You know, it's happening in China, for example, and I'm sure that's not the direction that we want Europe to go. Although there is uncertainty about green transition, the uncertainty is not related so much to exclusively to green technologies. We have the same uncertainties with the digital technologies and artificial intelligence. That's what I was saying there, that unlike previous technologies where there was a no-brainer in which direction you would go, we have a lot of choice on where to go, and the more successful companies will be the ones that, for one reason or another, will capture the imagination of the public. They will have a product that will be more attractive, and they will be the successful ones. We see this all the time. You know, like in 2005, probably the leading leading mobile telephone was BlackBerry. By 2012, BlackBerries had gone because Steve Jobs decided to use the finger, as he was saying, to launch a phone, and it completely dominated. And that's the way modern technology goes. Whereas when we invented electricity, what I believe is the previous, or the computer for that matter, which are the previous big technologies, I don't think there was any question of what type of electricity there would be. You know, it's not like here. So what I believe is that the government should provide the infrastructure for this development, and we know that whatever green technology we go for, it will be digital. So develop a super fast broadband accessible to everyone, so that we can use the data. Especially use give incentives for research in the form of tax incentives, research projects. Encourage, this is very, very important actually, that we don't do very well in Europe, encourage much closer collaboration between universities, companies, under government funding. In fact, the Americans don't have government funding, but one thing they succeeded really beyond, way ahead everyone else, is the way universities collaborate with companies. There is Silicon Valley, there is MIT, Harvard in Boston, and elsewhere. In Europe, we don't have that at all. There is a small corridor around Cambridge, England, but nothing like the Americans. Germany is very successful in this, actually. They're not very successful in pure research, but they're successful in collaborations at the industrial level between universities. But that's where it's going to come from. You know, maybe the best green technology is one we haven't discovered yet. Now, of course, what's urgent now, as you're saying, is how to store energy, how to store green energy. And I don't really know. I mean, like another thing, I don't want to advertise the way I spend my time on it. But I mean, one thing that is done now, it's under current research and connections, is how to connect Egypt with Europe to bring solar energy from Egypt, because we cannot store it. Otherwise, if you could store solar energy in Africa and the Middle East, you know, and ship it onto Europe in the form of super efficient batteries, you would do it. Maybe one day we'll do it, and all those cables under the sea that are connecting North Africa with Europe will become old technology, but there are still billions and billions of euros being put into it. So my view is that open it up to competition as much as possible. Government provides the infrastructure, and universities and companies collaborate to provide the superstructure, and who knows, maybe we're going to build big digital companies to compete with the Americans, whereas now we just open the door to the Americans, and all the big digital companies that we have in Europe are American. You know, Google, Apple, even Amazon and all that. Tesla, we made the Americans that invented them the richest people in the world. And there's no reason why we shouldn't be doing it in Europe.
Very good. Chris, thank you very much. By the way, you all may know, but this is very important in line with Professor Pissarides just said. You may know that the Biden administration in the United States has actually approved a very special frame for industrial policy, something that the United States has not had for many years, with the exception perhaps of the defense industry. And the three areas chosen by the Biden administration and with a bipartisan support in both Congress and the Senate in the United States, one is semiconductors, the other is advanced technologies on healthcare, and the third is on green energy. Okay, so the U.S. is actually putting a big spending plan from the public sector to support research and development, and support also manufacturing capabilities around green energy. So this is something that we, you know, perhaps in Europe we should think about, that this energy transition will require perhaps additional investment, especially in research, coming from governments. So I have here.
Just want to join it. There is one issue that is very, very difficult to know how to address here when you're talking about government supporting it, which is if government has a certain amount of money to spend on research, on green energy or anywhere else, does it give it to the most successful, or does it give it to those who don't have access to funds elsewhere to achieve more equality across the country? It's very difficult to know what, but if you really go for efficiency and you want to succeed quickly, you should be supporting those who are already successful. And then you might be accused that you are being elitist, you are ignoring the rest of the country, and so on and so forth. But it doesn't, you know, at one time, the British Research Funding said, we cannot. You know, there's something called Russell Group in Britain, which is essentially London, Oxford, Cambridge. And most of the funding for research was going there. And they said, no, we should support outside the Russell Group because we should have more equality, we should revive other parts of the country. But the thing is that you don't get the results. So if you want to speed up the transition to green energy, what the efficiency question is that you should find the most successful researchers in green energy, put them all together into the same university and give them all the money and find other ways of supporting the rest of the country.
Very good. Well, thank you very much, Chris. Luis, I have here at least 7 questions on the issue of taxing those extra profits that banks are actually having or going to have because of the increase in interest rates.
The tax rate 100%.
Luis, I don't know if you would like to add any or comment on the recent decision that the ECB has actually made public on this.
Well, this is not related to energy, no? Well, let me say something on that. Sometimes in life, it's very important to go back to basics. First, our opinion tries to help governments. That's something that we overlook. And you know, our opinions try to help governments. Our opinion is non-binding. So, what we try is perhaps you know to give you know our assessment about you know levies, taxes. Not only in the case of the Spanish levy, it's as well you know in the past is something that we have done quite a lot in the past, is to give guidance from our perspective to governments because it's non-binding. And so sometimes you know there are angles that well perhaps you know have to take into consideration. At the end of the day, this is going to be a democratic decision taken by the Spanish Parliament. And well, there are other factors that for sure that they will take into consideration, that the government and the parliament will take into consideration. But there is an angle that is the angle of the supervisor, it's the angle of the ECB, and is in order to help the governments. They can follow it or they cannot follow it because it's not binding, but it's there. Hmm? So that's the first point. The second point that I would like to make with respect to that is that you know we have a well-established policy line. This is not a novelty. You know, the opinion that we released yesterday is something that we have been elaborating for a long period of time. Because in other countries, you know, some kind of levies, taxes were introduced in the banking industry to tax the banking industry. And so we have elaborated that sort of policy line. And you know, the opinion that was published yesterday follows perfectly, dovetails perfectly to what we have been doing in the past. Third, it's a little bit about the process, because I think that the process is important to understand it. Whenever you know there is, because we release a lot of opinions on many things, the ECB, binding, non-binding, well, we are the supervisor, and so we have influence in that respect. No? But the way that we do it is we incorporate a panel. In the panel, and there are people and you know colleagues from many different areas of the ECB. We have people from economics, from monetary policy department, the monetary policy department, from financial stability, and from the supervisor, the SSM. Mm? And with the help of you know the National Central Bank, in this case the Bank of España, they produced an opinion. And it's the consequence of you know the track record that we have in terms of previous opinions, and you know the characteristics of in this case because not all the taxes, all the levies are identical. So it's something that is elaborated, that as I repeat again, is in order to help governments. It's up to them. You know, they fiscal policy is not our role, but fiscal policy has implications. And what we have to try to do is to underline the potential consequences that you know these levies or the taxes might have, you know, in solvency of the banking industry, credit growth, financing conditions, all these kind of things. That's the idea. But let me stress something that sometimes you know, because here I see that in Spain now, you know, the public opinion is a little bit polarized, you know, and. What we try is to help governments.
Very good. Thank you. Thank you very much, Luis. Chris, we have actually a couple of questions online, a number of them on paper, on the issue of skills and upskilling and training and retraining around energy transition. Some people actually ask you whether you know of some schemes that you may know in the UK or other European countries that have been successful in this area, and perhaps in a wider context of any technology transition that we've seen in the past. You pointed out the importance of digital transformation actually affecting energy transition as well. Could you offer the audience and also policymakers some reflection on how to tackle this skills gap that we see, even if the numbers for the energy industry are not that big, but any ideas for a frame to retrain those thousands of workers that may feel displaced over the next few years?
Yeah, I mean, the good news actually is that the skills you require for energy transition are not different from the skills that you require for all the other technological transitions that are taking place all the time. They are not more challenging, and they're not fundamentally different. So there isn't anything special to advise about energy transition skills that is different from what you advise, for example, for changing skills in manufacturing, in a manufacturing industry, or even in construction. Now, there is certainly a need for training, but the need for training and retraining has been emphasized since the year dot. You know, the European Union has been talking about the importance of lifelong learning. I remember conferences in the previous century about lifelong learning and retraining and upskilling all the time. So it's not something new. There is a lot of experience, of course, in money being spent on training, some wasted, some successful. I think the most successful forms of training here should be done at the company level, possibly subsidized by government, especially for small companies. But large companies like the one here now, it's more questionable whether they should be getting subsidies from the government. I wouldn't object to them actually, to the subsidies. I would use the tax they raise from the banks to subsidize the training at the company level. We know also from studies I've been following, in fact, it is now from the management side and reading some of the management literature to see what successes they are. And in fact, the most successful companies are large companies now. There are economies of scale in company efficiency. And they're the ones that train workers from within and offer different roles, train the worker to be able to perform different roles within the company so that they transition within the company to different sections of the company rather than firing the worker because she has some old-fashioned skills and then trying to find someone from outside to come in. So it's like it's a more dynamic environment, if you like, within the company. And when I was referring to experience that we're gaining about what's good quality jobs, and they're the ones that the worker has more autonomy and more selection of what they do and in job design, it's precisely this aspect, that when the worker is hired, then they are told, you know, don't think that this is what you'll be doing all the time in this company. Think all the time how to improve your job. We might be bringing in new technology. Don't feel scared by the new technology. Think what opportunities is opening up for you and what new roles you can create to improve the quality of our product and then move up from there. In those situations, it's very difficult to get government subsidization because it's not easily defined as to it's not like the worker is leaving one day a week to go to some external source of training, which might be run by the government. In fact, I don't think those forms of training are successful anymore. Green transition should come from large companies, and it should come from research within as to what's the best form of that green transition and what skills the workers should have, because the distance to the new skills compared with the ones they have now is short enough to be achieved with collaboration between the HR department, more senior people in the company, and the worker themselves.
Very good. Well, thank you very much, Chris, for these very insightful reflections on training and retraining. There are a few questions, Luis, for you on the financial dimensions of the energy transition, and some of them refer to the role of the European Central Bank. One of them says European Central Bank is trying to adopt a leading role in fighting against climate change by forcing, analyzing, reviewing lending policies by banks. This is something that is happening already. Is there any other way to foster from the European Central Bank investment in energies of the future? Any other measure, any other policy that you may contemplate now or in the future?
Well, the supervisor, the SSM, the supervisory part of the ECB, what is doing as you know, responsible for the monitoring of the banks, is to try to make sure that the banks are fully aware of the potential risks that they are running in their banking activities when dealing with different sectors and different industries. So. Sometimes, you know, the potential negative impact, detrimental impact of the climate transition, that we can talk about fiscal risks or even, you know, the green transition, is that banks cannot take into full consideration, you know, the potential impact that this might have in the solvency of their clients. So what you know, the supervisor is trying to do is to make sure that banks are fully aware of these potential considerations, because the transition is going to take place sooner or later, and it can have you know, an impact on the solvency of the clients of the banks, of the borrowers of the banks, and this can have indirectly an impact on the solvency of the bank. And simultaneously, in our case, with respect to our investments, our non-monetary and monetary portfolios, because we have quite a few securities in our balance sheet, is to try to help, you know, and to create externalities for the rest of the financial community through the practices that we are putting in place. The question of disclosures is going to be key. You know, what's the footprint? What are going to be, you know, the policies that the different issuers are going to pursue? What's going to be, you know, the final impact of the transition? What's the exposure to physical risks, to disasters, for the different corporates that we hold their bonds? And this is something that we are doing now. We are not buying bonds, but we are reinvesting bonds. And we have started to tilt our reinvestment decisions. In the near future, for sure, that you know, if we start with the QT process, that is the reduction of our balance sheet, well, then our possibilities will be more limited. But now QE is part of the toolkit of any central bank. And so this is something that we are trying to do. We are trying to foster disclosures in order to give an example to the rest of the financial system. Nevertheless, the first line of defense in terms of the fight against climate change is in the hands of the governments.
Very good. Thank you very much, Luis. We have many questions. My apologies, because we won't have time to read them all. I have here four questions on the same theme that I would like to perhaps summarize, or a question for both Professor Pissarides and Mr. de Guindos, which is whether, in the current context of this huge energy crisis around the war in Ukraine, whether the European Union or Europe, European Union plus the UK, should have a common energy policy or should have a more coordinated energy policy. And the number of people here who would like to know your views on this. I know, Chris, if you want to start with.
There's absolutely no doubt in my mind that there should be a coordinated energy policy, especially the European Union. I mean, it's very difficult to get the United Kingdom to collaborate on anything with Europe nowadays.
Let's hope this will will change somehow in the near future.
Well, the election is in 2 years' time. Let's hope there is a change. But there's no doubt at all. You see, with energy, it's something you got close to saying it before, but you didn't. What's happening is that we cannot avoid the more expensive energy price now. Whatever happens, whatever we do with inflation, with the transition of these higher prices for energy into other commodities, at the end of the day, we have to live with relatively more expensive energy. And how do we do that? We also have it's something that they haven't decided. You know, monetary policy cannot do anything about that. The higher relative price for energy will be there forever, whatever monetary policy does. Fiscal policy can do something about who bears the burden. And we definitely need collaboration there, but it's one of the principles of the European Union that fiscal policy should be in the hands of national governments, so we're not getting much collaboration there either. But with respect to policy, though, we have the commitment to at least half of the green transition in the next decade. Let's collaborate and accelerate in that direction. And what I was mentioning before about connecting North Africa with Europe is part of that project, because although the pipes in the first instance might come, in fact, I know one that is going to Cyprus and from Cyprus to Greece and from Greece to Europe, although it concerns those countries, they're European projects. They are not uniquely national projects. And that's what we should be doing. That's what we should be collaborating with. You know, I mean, like, I don't know, we don't have time to get me started on that, but I mean, it is absurd, for example, that that Germany is the biggest user of solar energy in Europe, I think. But most of their solar panels are located in Germany. I think it's crazy. I mean, that's where they should come and locate them. You know, you have so much sunny southern Europe that, you know, you have thousands of uninhabited Greek islands. Go and fill them up with photovoltaics and put cables to transform the energy to Germany. That's the kind of collaboration that we need to have to increase efficiency and increase output. Not have them there as isolated, only seagulls go and nest up there, or some or some tourist who wants privacy in the Aegean Sea, which I don't blame them, you know, I mean, it's not fun. Instead of using it to achieve the green transition and stop this dependency on Russia when they're so unpredictable.
Thank you, Chris. Luis, would you like to make some remarks?
Well, you know, perhaps, you know, two remarks, because I am in full agreement with the comments made by Christopher. First, I think that in Europe we have learned how detrimental is to depend from fossil fuel imports from Russia. That's the first lesson. The second lesson is that energy can be a geopolitical weapon, and it has been used, it's used by Russia now. And this is something they are weaponizing. I don't know whether you know in English you have that that expression, weaponizing energy. In order to hurt their rivals. And third, I think that now energy is on the top of the agenda of the European Union, of the European Commission, of the Council. I think that some decisions are going to be taken. Sometimes are not easy, because the structure of the countries is quite different. Look at France, look at Germany. But I think that sooner or later, this perception that we should be a little bit more independent from some energy producers, and the question of energy could become, you know, a weapon against the values in Europe, is something that will prevail, and we will have a much more united energy market in the Union.
Very good. Well, Luis, thank you very much. Chris, thank you very much. I would like to perhaps highlight at the end of this, I think, incredibly exciting, intellectually exciting session, perhaps three very, very simple messages. I mean, each one of you has got the messages that you actually found most interesting. But I would like first to actually highlight this very interesting white framework that Professor Pissarides shared with us on thinking about energy transition as one more type of technology transition with job destruction, but also job creation, and the need to offer the new skills, the new training that employees that may be displaced or future employees, younger people who will join the job market, you know, should have around the new energy sources and the new energy types of generation that we'll see in the future. I think that's very important because puts, I think, you know, an element of rationality when we think about the future of energy. It's not just, you know, an individual choice, a choice of a government. You know, trying to put some rationality behind this is extremely important. And the support of governments to make sure that the distributional effect, especially for those people who lose their jobs in more traditional fossil fuel types of energy generation, that could have future options in terms of jobs. Second highlight for me is this very clear, I think, frame that Luis de Guindos has shared with us on the perspective of the European Central Bank on fighting inflation and the goals and the tools of monetary policy, and also the determination of the European Central Bank to really bring inflation down. He actually recognized that you know, this inflationary pressure that we're suffering from today has both a combination of demand and supply factors. At the end of the day, we are also now sensing the legacy of the many years of, you know, huge liquidity in the economy, and the normalization of monetary policy is indispensable. I think it's very good to hear that that the European Central Bank is very determined actually to bring this inflationary cycle, okay, down to zero as soon as possible. I think it's important because at the end of the day, there is no worse economic disease than having a sustained high inflation rate in the economy, because everybody suffers. And then the third point that I would like to perhaps highlight in this final part of the conversation is the importance of applying rationality, and that's very important, applying our reason, okay, to think about us as citizens, as executives of companies, entrepreneurs, but also asking governments to apply this rationality when we think about energy planning for the future. And I think the reflections both on the need to have a more integrated, a more coordinated European energy policy, and think about the research necessary with the funding of governments and the interaction of governments, universities and companies to think about new and explore new sources of energy for the future, I think is really indispensable. For me, and this is the final message, I think this conversation and the presentations of Professor Pissarides and Mr. Luis de Guindos, I think a signal of hope, okay? Sometimes in the daily debates, what we read, what we listen, what, you know, many debates are about prepositions, pre-ideas, on preconceived ideas on something. I think that we've had a wonderful, rational, reflective debate on energy transition, on jobs around energy transition, on monetary policy and financial policy to support energy transition. And this is, I think, the type of debate that we should expect and that we should actually ask in our society to have on these and other very important social issues. So please join me thanking Professor Pissarides and Mr. Luis de Guindos for their fantastic performance today here at IESE. And thank you very much for being with us today. Thank you.